to you about the first part of my dissertation project at the University of Connecticut. Like Tom said, testing the parallel speciation hypothesis using phylogenomic data in California skinks. Now, as biologists, we're all familiar with bifurcating tree-like speciation, where species evolve from reproductive isolation from their closest relatives, often due to some kind of shift in phenotype. We're also really familiar with a related situation, bifurcating speciation with parallel evolution. Here, again, lineages acquire reproductive isolation from their closest relative, but here, two or more lineages evolve a similar phenotype. So in this case, B and C have evolved this orange colored parallel. What I want to talk to you about today is a subset of parallel evolution called parallel speciation. In parallel speciation, again, lineages acquire reproductive isolation from their closest relatives, but here, the parallel lineages B and C have also evolved due to this parallel phenotype. So B and C are now reproductively compatible because they share the orange phenotype. So the group of species that I work on is called the Plesteon Skinks species complex, a group of skinks located in the western regions of the United States. And this complex itself is a putative example of parallel speciation. So the complex is made up of three different species: a small body Plesteon Skinks species, a much larger body Plesteon gilberti, and another small body skink, Plesteon lamensis, which is endemic to Baja California. Now, my collaborator, Jonathan Richman, did work in the early 2000s showing that differences in body size actually act as a very strong mechanical prezygotic barrier in this system. So, thus, the larger skink species, Plesteon gilberti, could only successfully achieve copulation with other skinks of very similar size and could not successfully achieve copulation posture with its smaller Skiltomianus and Lagomensis relatives. And this wouldn't be entirely surprising for a species, but when John put together the mitochondrial phylogeny for the group, he discovered that Plesteon gilberti actually putatively represented three independent evolutions of large body size, once in the Sierra foothills in California, once in a large, widely distributed area in southwestern California, and once in the Indian Mountains of California. So John had actually shown three key criteria for the parallel speciation hypothesis for this group. He had shown reproductive isolation between the gilberti and Skiltomianus through the mechanical body size barrier. He had shown reproductive compatibility between gilberti, because they share this parallel trait, and he had shown supposedly independent origins of these parallel traits with the mitochondrial phylogeny. But of course, as we know, just like the previous talk, mitochondrial introgression can be quite common. So my goal for this project was to test the independent origins of Plesteon gilberti using modern phylogenomic techniques. And to do this, I used the anchor phylogenomics approach in collaboration with to sequence hundreds of semi-conserved nuclear loci. And so what I did was I sampled 14 representative samples from across the mitochondrial clades of the complex. So we were very successful in doing this, and we obtained 387 phase loci for about 640,000 sites, about which 12,000 were phylogenetically informative. So my first approach was to create a phylogeny based on this new data to see if the nuclear genome also shared this signal independent origin of the gilberti. And the obvious result was this. Right here, you have a monophyletic gilberti, which stands in stark contrast to the mitochondrial phylogeny. We also see this other notable difference from the mitochondrial phylogeny. Clade with Plesteon lamensis grouping with Plesteon skiltomianus mitochondrial group 1. And this is an interesting result that I'll come back to later. But it was obvious at this point that there was a major conflict between the nuclear genome and the mitochondrial genome. And we know that a major source of these kinds of conflicts are introgression. But there are actually two competing introgressive scenarios that can lead to this exact kind of conflict, depending on which history you believe actually represents the original branching history. So if you believe the mitochondrial history is the original history, then we know that given sufficient introgression between parallel forms, and this gene trees will actually start reflecting the each regressive history at greater and greater rates of migration. But second, if you believe the nuclear history is correct, what I just showed you, then we know that mitochondrial capture, again, can be common, and the mitochondrial capture has actually led to an erroneous mitochondrial phylogeny that makes it look like parallel speciation has taken place. So, my next step was to examine the distribution of gene tree topology. So basically, I wanted to know if my anchor loci carried a single coherent signal for mitochondria, for monophyletic nuclei, or if there's a large amounts of gene tree heterogeneity that I was dealing with. And I'm definitely dealing with large amounts of gene tree heterogeneity. So only about 2.5% of the gene tree showed a topology that contained the same clades as the species tree topology, like this one I'm showing you up here. An additional 14.5% of the gene trees reflect a monophyletic gilberti, but with different groupings of the Skiltonianus groups. And these are either unresolved or just different from the nuclear phylogeny. And then in a whopping 83% of the gene trees, it showed either a non-monophyletic gilberti, as you see here, or just the gene tree wasn't resolved enough to make show whether or not gilberti was monophyletic. But I also knew that many of my loci possessed very few phylogenetically informative sites. And these loci with very low numbers of informative sites are especially prone to errors in gene tree estimation. So considering the results of my species tree analysis, I expected that as I discounted trees with low information, the proportion of gene trees reflecting monophyletic nuclei would actually increase. And so to measure my gene tree information, I used the software Galix, was developed by Paul Lewis, who saw his talk last night, which uses a Bayesian approach to measure information content in a given gene tree. And so, surprisingly, as I discounted trees with low information at strict stricter thresholds, so see here you see the distribution of gene trees considering all of my gene trees in my data set. As I discounted gene trees with lower information at stricter and stricter thresholds, the distribution of qualities actually remained remarkably similar to the distribution considering all of my trees. So even among the top 10% of gene trees with the greatest amount of information, the large majority of gene trees still do not possess a monophyletic nuclei. So in short, the informative gene trees have a hefty amount of heterogeneity between them. That's not just due to lack of information in my gene trees. So a major source of this is certainly due to incomplete lineage sorting, but in both of the evolutionary scenarios I've talked about, either parallel speciation or mitochondrial introgression, plays a major role. So my question is, can I actually pick up signals of introgression despite having this much incomplete lineage sorting in my gene tree topologies? So I took two approaches in order to get at this question. The first approach was that gene trees with the earliest divergences actually represent the original branching history. My second approach was to estimate the phylogenetic network using programs like Phylonet. And if you have any interest in these kinds of estimations, I would suggest going to their talks immediately after mine because they're happening right now. So let's talk about this first approach. So this approach was based on a simulation study by Lachey et al. In 2013 and a recent publication by Fontaine et al. In 2015. And their basic stipulation was that for any given three taxon combination or triplet, gene tree topologies with earliest divergences represented the true branching history. So the tree that you see above right here represents a true branching history, assuming the mitochondrial phylogeny is correct. So here, time one is the node that splits unpaired taxa A from paired taxa B and C. And time two is the node that splits paired taxa B and C. So now let's assume that A introgresses into B. So given sufficient migration rates from A to B, some portions of the gene trees will show a switch now where A and B become paired taxa, and in addition, the T2 node now occurs later in time, specifically at the time of introgression. And this case is similar if there's introgression from B to A or if there's bidirectional introgression. So again, in some portion of the gene trees, A and B become the paired taxa now, and node T2 occurs later. However, in this case, node T1 occurs later as well. Since in the introgression tree, time 1 is actually the same as time 2 in the original branching history. So I wanted to perform this test on my data set, a test that I informally call the T1, T2 test. So in order to perform this, I first estimated rooted strict clock ultrametric trees for each of my angular subfamilies. And then I pruned my ultrametric trees to only include 3 samples. These were a given Gilbertite sample, its closest Skiltonianus relative according to the mitochondrial phylogeny, and its closest Gilbertite relative according to the nuclear phylogeny. And as we do this for each gene tree, you get these triplets right here. We do this across many gene trees, and you see that triplets fall into one of 3 possible topologies. You either have a mitochondrial topology, an alternative topology which occurs due to incomplete lineage sorting, and a nuclear topology as well. So each time I did this for my gene trees, I measured the T1 and T2 node depths by standardizing against that gene's output print. So importantly, the mitochondrial phylogeny does in fact represent the true branching history, then I expect gene trees with nuclear topologies to possess at least later time 2 divergences. So I tested 10 different triplet combinations using Gilbertite and Skiltonianus. So what I want to start off with was the result for this combination right here, the southwestern Gilbertite clade, Skiltonianus group 9, and the Indo group 9. So here's that result. And what you can see, first, I did not see significant differences between the time 1 distributions for any of the topologies. And you can see as well, I didn't see any significant differences in the time 2 distributions, at least between the nuclear topology distributions and the mitochondrial topology distributions. However, I did get this alternative topology occurring earlier, an interpretation of which I'm not sure what to make of quite yet. I did see 3 combinations which did exhibit earlier mitochondrial topology divergences, and that's an interesting result in itself. I want to briefly talk about my second approach using phylogenetic networks. And phylogenetic networks are trees where a given node can have greater than 1 parent node. Basically, it can estimate introgression events. So I used phylet for this, which is a maximum likelihood approach to estimating networks. And I got 2 networks out of this estimation. One using random material sampled from my individuals. And here I see 2 reticulation events in the tree. But importantly, I do see this monophyletic Gilbertite. So I see monophyletic Gilbertite with evidence of introgression into a Skiltonianus group. I also see it if I give phylogenet all my alleles and I map them to specific individuals. Again, I see introgression between a monophyletic Skiltonianus clade and a monophyletic Gilbertite clade. So this seems to be quite a case of tangled speciation. But does Gilbertite actually represent 3 dependent evolutions of large body size? Species trees say no, but of course we're not allowing for introgression here. With the informal T1, T2 test, I don't see evidence of independent origins of Phylogenomic Gilbertite, but I do have these exceptions. And in my phylogenetic networks, I do see introgression events, but I still see monophyletic Gilbertite clade. So this, of course, means that nuclear topology being the true topology. So then how do these species actually manage to break the ankle? Here's I got a barrier. The networks imply these ancestral introgressions, perhaps prior to body size divergence, so perhaps correlation wasn't as difficult.